Our next speaker is Dr. Rick Nabb, who's the director of the National Hurricane Center. For those of you watching online who may not know a whole lot about the National Weather Service, we have a video that we're going to play for you. And as soon as we come out of that video, then Dr. Nabb will be here in front of the camera starting to talk about the 2016 hurricane season, some products that are coming, and all sorts of things. It's always a pleasure to have Dr. Nabb come here. You know, he lives and works in Miami, which is a elevation of what? Zero? and coming to 9,600 feet is always a challenge. So we really do appreciate you coming here and presenting to us. So let me take a look at this video, and please join me so you can learn a little bit about the National Weather Service.
Not on.
Yeah,
okay.
Where's the microphone on here?
Right here.
Just take it.
Like the old days on television.
Yep.
There you go.
Okay, thanks. Hear me okay now? Okay. I'll start over. Dr. Rick Nabb, Director of National Hurricane Center, here from Miami, arrived yesterday. Always a pleasure to participate here in the Weather and Climate Summit. And as Dave Jones alluded to, it is a climatic adventure for me. And he ordered me for the last few weeks to drink a lot of water, hydrate fully. And so what I did was I used up all of my water stock from hurricane season. So I had like 10 gallons of water in these boxes that I fortunately didn't have to use, and I just drank them all after the new year. So that's awesome. part of my preparations for the next hurricane season. I gotta go get my water again. Yeah, so January is the beginning of my travel season. It's the beginning of our outreach and education season and getting ready for the next hurricane season. A lot of folks think when it comes to January, I breathe a big sigh of relief. Ah, hurricane season's over, it's winter, I don't have to deal with snowstorm forecasting, that's not my thing. So I take it easy, and nothing could be further from the truth. We spend the next few months getting ourselves ready for the next season, and that involves upgrading our computer systems and enhancing our products and getting ready for what we're going to come out with that's brand new this year, which I'll share a lot with you today about. And we do a lot of outreach and education. We got to get the public and our partners in emergency management and media and many other organizations ready for the hurricane season. Because as I've said year after year, we can do all of the new products and warnings that we want, and we can have all kinds of new emergency management procedures, and our media partners can be the most excellent communicators on the planet, and we can all work on all of that together. But if people in the public aren't ready and they don't do what they need to do to get ready for the next hurricane, then all of that work doesn't realize its full potential. But that's the ultimate goal. I'll finish with that later on this morning. But gosh, how many years now I've been talking about how important it is for us to focus on the hurricane hazards. You know, we, for years and years, and I'm sure this will be no different, we spend a lot of time talking about how to get people to understand what hazards could occur where they live and get them to respond properly when a hurricane brings all the different hazards their way. And what often stands in the way of people understanding what they need to do is getting hung up on what the category of the hurricane is, or getting hung up on what the track of the hurricane was. It didn't show it going right over their house. Or what did we call it? Did we call it post-tropical? Was it not a tropical cyclone yet? What category was it? Should we have been writing advisories on that system? Should we have not? I mean, how we categorize things in the weather business still is often one of the biggest challenges between us and the public responding properly. And that's why this whole mantra of focusing on the hazards has been a core of what we've been doing the last few years and is really the main motivation for the changes that we are right in the midst of making right now. We're in the middle of a several year, pretty aggressive set of changes to our products and warnings in the tropical program in the National Weather Service. A lot of that is because of the reasons I just stated, but it's also because of a lot of evolving needs from our partners in emergency management and the media. We're trying to meet evolving needs that they are trying to meet their constituents with. And so it really does come down to focusing on the hazards, and that means more products and more warnings in an era in which we're also trying to grapple with, well, there are too many products to sort through. There are too many different kinds of warnings. So there is a tug of war going on there, trying to figure out what new thing we should bring to the table is going to, on balance, be a benefit and not just add to the confusion. So that's the big challenge. And we, unfortunately, had a pretty busy and impactful hurricane season internationally and in the U.S. in 2016. But of course, as all of meteorology knows, whenever you have bad weather, that's the chance to test your new products, right? And so the way I'm going to share with you what's coming in 2017 is largely based on what we did in 2016, which gave us a chance to do some of the experimental versions of the products that are coming. And actually, we were able to debut some new things operationally. So you'll see a lot of what happened in 2016. I'm not going to show a lot of satellite images. I trust that a bunch of meteorologists in the room saw the satellite imagery in real time, don't need me to show it to you again. I'm going to focus a lot on what the products were conveying, how we were briefing them, how to interpret them, and what changes we're trying to make to them going forward. Now, some of this information I know many of you have seen before many multiple times, but we have done some additional work on the fatalities in tropical cyclones during the past year or two that some of you maybe have not seen. What many of you have probably seen before is based on this study that our deputy director, Ed Rappaport, published in 2014. This is a 50-year study of U.S. tropical cyclone fatalities, the direct causes of fatalities. And I wanted to revisit this along with a companion study that he just completed last year to set the stage for putting into context what happened last year, and again provides us additional motivation and rationale for why we're changing the products the ways that we are. So many of you have seen the pie chart there on the left summarizing the different ways that people have died due to the direct forces of the storm. So this has to do with dying in, drowning in floods, or experiencing flying debris and dying from blunt force trauma in non-tornadic winds or being affected by a tornado. And we've said over and over again how we think of tropical storms and hurricanes mainly as wind machines, and they are, and the winds can be damaging and even deadly, but at the time the way we lose lives is from the water. And what you don't see from the pie chart on the left is that most of the storm surge fatalities come from about a half dozen really big events. Katrina's on that list, Sandy's on that list, Camille, Betsy. So the storm surge fatalities tend to come in really big events in really large numbers. You don't tend to lose one or two from storm surge this year and then one or two the next year. You tend to lose a few hundred at a time in a big event. And then maybe a few years go by and you lose a few more hundred, or at least a few dozen. And those are really the most heartbreaking events that we are trying to lessen the impacts from with the new storm surge products. But storm surge isn't the only water-related hazard that's taking lives, and when you add up all the water hazards, 9 out of 10 people that die in tropical cyclones in the U.S. die due to water. And we don't have to think very hard about 2016 to realize that that happened again, both from storm surge and freshwater flooding. We lose a lot of people at the beach and on boats, but we do lose a lot of people from wind as well. But if you look at the chart on the right, rainfall-induced inland flooding is the most frequent cause of direct fatalities in U.S. tropical cyclones. That's a statistic we haven't shared as widely as we should. What it means is more tropical cyclones cause people to die due to inland flooding than any other hazard. You cause that to happen more frequently. So you might have several tropical cyclones come ashore in the U.S. without one storm surge fatality. But in the interim, you might have several of them, depressions, storms, hurricanes, the remnants of these things, that cause at least one fatality due to inland flooding. And that's why nearly all of you are affected by that statistic, coastal or inland. Tropical cyclones have come into most of your areas and caused impacts, including fatalities. Surge is not the most frequent cause of fatalities. It's pretty far down the list, but when it does happen, it tends to come in and cause a large number. If you want to read the details of that study, I wanted to share this for those of you who wanted to really dive into this. I mean, talk about some really good source material for blogs and social media posts and stories. I mean, to really get into the details of the study that led to these statistics that I just showed you. Came out in March 2014 in the Bulletin of the AMS. You can get it online at the link there. But now we've done a companion study. And again, we is our deputy director and colleagues. Ed did most of the work, and I want to share with you some of those statistics. And this is really illuminating, because if you think about what happened in 2016, if you think about what happened in many past tropical cyclone events in the U.S., a lot of these causes of fatalities will come to our minds. And by running the numbers, it really brings home the volume of the problem, that fatalities that happen in association with a tropical cyclone that aren't the direct forces of the storm, it's not drowning, it's not blunt force trauma, it's not the direct forces of the storm, but that probably wouldn't have happened if the tropical cyclone didn't happen, that's where these fatalities come in. This study is for the same 50-year period, 63 to 2012, for U.S. I'll give you the link to the full report that came out in 2016. And on this relatively complicated pie chart, I'll try to pick out some of the big issues that we have determined. And you start to realize that we've got an outreach and education mission that this should motivate us to take on, that isn't just about saving people from the storm surge when it's happening and saving people from the wind when it's happening, but it's about getting people to do things as safely as possible, preparing for the storm and during the storm and even for some time after the storm. People die in all of those time periods, and when you add it all up, the fatalities from these indirect causes are almost the same number over the 50-year period as the direct fatalities. And that's staggering to me. That means we've got a lot of work to do to get the word out to these folks who are losing their lives this way. Yes, sir.
Jim Candy, WLTX in Columbia, South Carolina. Got a question for you on this, and this one, it's kind of interest to me. In South Carolina, you've got a fairly large percentage there for cardiovascular incident. Did the study break down what was causing those cardiovascular incident? I mean, you know, what were these people doing that caused them to have a heart attack?
Yeah, good question. Some of those details we have and are contained in the full report that I'll give you the link to. Now, just to give you a little bit of background, the study was done by compiling information from hundreds of sources to try to pull together what the causes of death were. In some cases, there was a lot of detail. In other cases, not so much. But in general terms, you had people experience cardiovascular incidents that were exerting themselves before the storm in preparation. They were exerting themselves afterwards in cleanup. They were in stressful situations. Any number of things could have been the trigger, or they just happened at the time of the cyclone, and they're in this because we don't have any real definitive way to separate the incident from the cyclone, so it's included here. But clearly, a lot of them are directly associated with the preparations, the cleanup, and the stress of the event, and probably wouldn't have happened without the event. Evacuation is a complex one, and this is why, because evacuation is not without its dangers, this is why when emergency managers call for evacuations, as a result of the information and the decision support that we're providing them from the National Weather Service, they don't do it lightly, because they know that there's not a zero risk in calling for thousands of people to get on the roads and evacuate. And these statistics bear that out, that sometimes the cardiovascular incidents occurred in the course of evacuation, for whatever reason, or that occurred in the course of being in a vehicle accident. That was during the evacuation, but other vehicle accidents were not during the evacuation. So there's some overlap here. Then there's a lot of vehicle accidents, and again, we don't attribute every death in a vehicle to be a direct aspect of the forces of the storm. If people hadn't been in that vehicle, they probably wouldn't have died from the forces of the storm unless they got into danger other ways. So the vehicle accidents are considered to be indirect. And then you have trees are involved in so many fatalities. Some of them are involved in direct fatalities. We lost some people in South Florida during Katrina in 2005 with trees falling onto cars, for example. That would be a direct cause, because the person was sitting in their car and they were parked, right? It wasn't a vehicle accident. The tree did the damage and caused the fatality. But sometimes there are trees on down roads, and then there's a vehicle accident running into the down tree. And this gets into the issues about when we're on television and elsewhere saying, why don't you stay off the roads while the authorities clean up after the storm? That sounds like a cliche. Oh, yeah, they tell me to stay off the roads. People die when they don't do that. And that's where these statistics really bear out, that a lot of the things that we tend to say and remind people of that they might dismiss as just being stuff that your mom says because she's worried about you are actually life-saving statements. And here's one that really is a big deal, the power issue. We don't often think about electrical power outages as being in and of themselves potentially deadly. I mean, obviously in winter storms, it's an issue, and in so many other situations, we know it is an issue, but I don't think folks in hurricane-prone areas, when they think about their list of things they worry about that could cause them harm, they don't necessarily think about the power outage being harmful, but it certainly can be, and it's usually because something else happens as a result of responding to the power outage or the conditions that people find themselves in as a result of the power outage. It happened in 2016 in one or more of the U.S. landfalling cyclones this year, where people cranked up the generators and we lost people due to carbon monoxide poisoning. Happened again in 16. This is a current issue. It's not in these statistics, but it'll add to them. And some people light open flames and it causes a fire. And in tropical cyclones that happen in certain times of year when it can be cold afterwards, Sandy's an example. You can put people in dangerously cold conditions without heat. And then, of course, people who need medical equipment that are power dependent, that can be a problem. Look at the bottom one, that 4% that shows a graphic indicating falling. Now you might think, okay, well, that doesn't happen very often. Probably doesn't happen to many people. It's only 4% of the total. But that hit me personally, almost. During the 2004-2005 hurricane seasons in South Florida, when we had to prepare over and over again, I almost lost a family member who had fallen off a ladder, putting their shutters up, and hit their head on the pavement. Fortunately, not hard enough that it took their life, but that was a close one, And so these are all real ways in which people you and I know personally could get themselves into trouble, not to mention all the people that we communicate with and serve. So I'm hoping this is information that we can all use to provide a source material motivation in our outreach and education efforts, and in real time, during the lead up to the storm. After we finish talking about what the European and the GFS might do, we could also throw in things about what you can do to avoid getting yourself into trouble even before the storm gets there. And when the storm has gone by, there's a lot to do to keep people safe. Now, when you combine all of this with the direct fatalities, this is the entire picture of what's taking lives in U.S. tropical cyclones. Now, there's a lot of complexities here, and there are some uncertainties, like there's that bottom area where it says storm surge or indirect. A lot of this has to do with not really knowing for sure how people died after Katrina, whether or not they were indirectly affected or whether or not they were directly killed by the storm surge. There's a lot of uncertainty there. But generally speaking, it's almost half and half, the direct causes and the indirect causes. And the direct effects of storm surge, say it's around 20% of the total. It's not that much different than the combination of cardiovascular failure and power outages. And we spend a lot of time talking about storm surge, but not those other things. I've talked a lot about this with some of the folks in the healthcare industry already. They're very interested in using this information in their outreach and education. And I thought you'd find it interesting and motivating and perhaps as source material. And speaking of that, here's the link again to the BAMS. This article came out in 2016, and encourage you to read it to get additional details. Yes, sir.
Greg Fischel, WRAL in Raleigh. How do you all feel about television stations telling people not to get out on the road and then getting out on the road? In other words, our reporters and so forth and photographers are doing the very thing we're telling people not to do?
I don't have a blanket, I hate that or I love that answer, because it really does depend on how it's handled, how it's done, and what is conveyed, because there are dangers and there are potential miscommunications, but there are great potential therefore getting across some very useful information. If you're in an area that's got an evacuation called and you bring up the emergency manager who's just been going door to door trying to get people out, and he can share a few last minute pieces of information, that's helpful. I think it is helpful for people to see what happens when storm surge comes ashore, but I don't want people putting themselves in harm's way to get that kind of footage. Technology, I think, is making it a little more feasible to get that kind of footage without a person being in harm's way, for example. Mm-hmm. And since you're in Raleigh, I'm getting a little ahead of myself. I was going to mention this later, but I'll mention it now. I do want to explore ways that we can get more pre-storm live coverage outside in inland areas. So that we can highlight this downtown area here where this river is calmly going by right now, this could flood. And if authorities tell you to get out of this area as rain starts to fall, you need to get out. Just to highlight the inland flood threat, there's so many ways that we could do that creatively, and there's some emergency management angles to that that I can get back to later. But anyway, the answer to your question, TV coverage, out in the field during events, it depends on how you do it. And what the message that's being conveyed. You can put the same person in the same place, and I would react differently depending on what they're saying. Or you could say the right thing and be in a very dangerous place, and I would think, well, I'd rather you say that, a couple miles farther inland where you're not putting yourself in harm's way and giving the impression that it's okay to be there. It really depends on how you do it.
Jim Gandy, WLTX in Columbia, South Carolina. Let me get back to your point here about the inland flooding. When Matthew hit, it took us by surprise, the extent of the river flooding, because we had no idea ahead of time that Nichols was going to go underwater. And while we did a really good job, I think, of focusing on the coast and identifying those areas that were going to be affected by storm surge, by high winds. Inland areas, we covered the same thing, because I'm in Columbia, so I'm 2 hours away from the coast. And you know, we were trying to give everybody an idea, and I think we did a good job. But, and I made this point to the NOAA team that came in afterwards to evaluate. I said, you know something? We did a lousy job of river flooding. We have point forecast, but that doesn't translate to the town downstream. What we need is some kind of graphic that comes up that gives us how much water is going to be in that floodplain. I know that's difficult, but it would certainly go a long way to addressing what you were saying about the river flooding inland.
Mm-hmm. Rick, Dale Eck, Weather Channel. I want to point to that because that was something I left a pit in my stomach after the end of Matthew, was that while all along, and I'm not trying to throw darts at what TV did or whatever, but all along, you know, we had the winds, we had the surge graphics, we were showing 12 inches or more of rain across South Carolina, and you know, one extra sentence. Now, this could lead to some significant river flooding. I don't know that we have the technology to predict the river flooding before the rain actually happens, but I felt like there's so much attention by the media focused on the coast. The forecast was there. It's just a question of how much emphasis did the media put on that. And I think that is the challenge.
And some of that, some of this is on us as well. I mean, we have already talked at great length inside the walls of the Hurricane Center and talked with WPC and Greg will share you know, his perspectives on the several events from last year, including Matthew, I'm sure. But we have already identified ways that we could highlight the inland flood threat even more so than we do in our existing products and hopefully with some ideas for new products that we can come up with. Because just like a few years ago with the storm surge hazard, where we didn't have really good graphics to convey the hazard, didn't have a warning for storm surge until we will this year, if things stay on track, as I think they will. Now we're starting to realize, well, we need in hurricane situations either to promote existing products and messages more fully on our website and in our Hurricane Center products, or we need additional new products to highlight that hazard. That's not lost on us at all. I think this is, everybody is going to have to play a role in ultimately getting the public to respond the way we want them to in inland flooding situations. Because if I don't have time to say this later, I wanted everybody to know, and I see your hand, I'll come to you, that in emergency management briefings, the heavy rainfall and inland flood hazard was heavily briefed for days in advance. And emergency managers, I know at the state level, for example, in North Carolina, were well aware of the threat. And you know, they saw the forecast, they saw our forecast, they saw the WPC information, they were talking to their WFOs. And there was a lot that, for example, emergency management in North Carolina did ahead of the storm so that they could respond to the flooding with swift water rescue teams and so forth. In many, many ways, on the emergency management side of things, this was not a decision support failure. But I, too, was surprised by the magnitude of the flooding in some of these communities, and Nichols is one example. The biggest challenge is going to be how to translate any enhanced messaging, better products, better communication on the hazard, better outreach and education ahead of time, which I think is a big piece of it, so that people don't get out on the roads, which is one of the main ways people lost their lives in North Carolina, was in cars. Not in places they were told to shelter, but out in cars. And that's not just a tropical cyclone problem, that's a problem that we see playing out over and over again throughout the country. So we all have a role to play on addressing that issue. Jennifer.
Jennifer Covina from WPSD. And maybe Greg can talk about this later too, but there is the Flash project with NSSL that can simulate. It'll take in model data as well as radar data and almost real time show you where the downstream flooding is going to occur. And even if it doesn't give you days or maybe even hours, it can give you minutes time to prepare cities. Like, are you be able to talk about that later?
This is
Yeah, I know.
But it's funny because you've got the Hurricane Center, and then you also depend on the National Weather Service both for that. But the NSSL project is more experimental still and research-based, but it's still worth looking at and using.
Yeah, Greg, talk about the national water models out there as well. Greg, I'm not going to steal a lot of Greg's thunder here, and a lot of what I'm going to talk about is storm surge products because those are the new things, and we got to test them thoroughly. And I don't have a lot of new Hurricane Center inland flood rainfall products to show you. That's a WPC thing, but I can already tell you I've talked with the WPC director, Dave Novak, extensively since this event, and we've already thought of new ways to communicate between one another during the event to make sure, make absolutely sure, just enhance what we're already doing, that the media message that we give through when we have the media poll going, that I'm reflecting what WPC is thinking and what their products are showing, front and center if that's the main issue going on, and that the emergency management briefings, which I think went really well, because we in WPC were talking to emergency managers at the national and state level, and that fed down to the locals for the WFOs. So there's a lot we and WPC already do together, but I think most of the product enhancements are going to come from WPC, because that's their thing, the inland flood thing. The question is going to be, how do we best highlight that in National Hurricane Center products and on our website? But when Greg gets up and talks about the events from last year, we can revisit some of these issues even more deeply. But again, I really do think when it comes to the outreach and education efforts that we do every hurricane off season, that the inland flood threat is something we have to hit on even harder. We've been doing that, and I'll finish off with this thought again at the end to reiterate, but last September, between Hermine and Matthew, we did a satellite media tour. Maybe, I can't remember if I was on some of your stations, from the Hurricane Center with Federal Alliance for Safe Homes, and we talked about water and flooding and flood insurance and turn around, don't drown, all that stuff. And we did it in advance of Matthew. Now, hopefully that made a positive difference and somebody, maybe one person, stayed off the road as a result of that effort. I don't know. But we got to do more of that because, like I said at the beginning, in general terms, all the new products and warnings and things that we say on television are only going to mean so much if we haven't ingrained it in our culture and people haven't been educated way ahead of time how dangerous it is to be out on the roads when there's flooding going on. So outreach and education is a part of it too, but products will be as well. So lots to talk about there. We are going to talk about storm surge too. And when you look at the 2016 hurricane season, what's not missing is a U.S. hurricane landfall. That hadn't happened in a while. Hermine broke that long drought of hurricanes hitting the U.S. But what you still don't see is a major hurricane, Category 3 or stronger, coming ashore at that intensity anywhere in the U.S. Just goes to show you that Matthew is another example in a long line of tropical storms and hurricanes that were not major hurricanes when they came ashore in the U.S., when the eye came ashore, but had major impacts. It happens over and over again. But, you know, Matthew's heritage as a major hurricane and coming very close to making landfall in Florida as a major hurricane, it reminds us just how vulnerable we are of not only getting a big storm surge and rainfall producing hurricane, but a really strong one from the wind. And that reminded me in South Florida because I put up my shutters for Matthew. Dave.
Rick, I have a question on that precise issue. How do you recommend that broadcasters, broadcast meteorologists communicate how impactful a storm can be regardless of the category? Because, you know, you have the size, you have surge, you have all of that stuff. How do you recommend that everybody here in the room and those watching online that are broadcasters do that more effectively?
Well, nearly everything I'm going to say between now and when I get off the stage here is going to partially answer that question, because one of the ways to get away from category and major hurricane versus not a major hurricane is to focus more on the hazards and to see what storm surge and wind and so forth could happen regardless of the intensity. And it's one of the reasons we've gone to these new storm surge products, because we had all of these big storm surge events and a lot of inland flooding events over the last now decade and a half without having a major hurricane be the causative event. And how many of those past events where it wasn't a major hurricane that before, during, and after, people expressed surprise, how could something that's not even a major hurricane have that big of an impact? And we know from so many systems after Wilma 2005, the last major hurricane to come ashore in the U.S., just you guys know the names. Ike is one of them, 2008. That wasn't a major hurricane when it hit the U.S. One of the costliest hurricanes in U.S. history. So educating people about the history is another part of the answer, Dave, is to remind everybody how many hurricanes and storms there have been that have not been major hurricanes. It just doesn't take that to have a major impact. And then Debbie Isaac, Sandy, 2012, Irene, 2011. Sandy was a really prominent example of just how big the impacts could be, even when it's losing its tropical characteristics for crying out loud. So that's why we have focused so much on the hazards, and it's why Hermine and Matthew especially, which I'm going to show some of the products that we issued for, will show you how you can see how major the impacts could be in a local community, regardless of what the intensity or the size is or what the category is. This was one of the busiest seasons we've had in quite a while. In fact, you'll see a graphic later that we wrote more advisories on the Atlantic side than we have in many years. So it was not only more busy for the U.S. in terms of landfalls, it was busier overall, and the East Pacific wasn't so quiet either. So we were quite busy. And by the way, you notice there at the bottom left, you see Otto? Otto was both an Atlantic and an Eastern Pacific tropical cyclone because over Thanksgiving it crossed over Central America, retained its identity as a tropical cyclone along the way, and it was still Otto in the Eastern Pacific, and was a very significant event down that far south as a Cat 4 that late in the season. That was pretty remarkable. And had some folks from Panama visit the Hurricane Center not long after the event, and it was pretty big deal for them, even though they didn't get the brunt of the wind. Okay, I want to go through a little bit of the meteorology here in terms of forecast verification before I get on to the products and how they performed. This is very preliminary. We are still, because of a very busy Atlantic and Eastern Pacific season, our hurricane specialists are still in the midst of doing their post-event analyses and writing the tropical cyclone reports, which can result in changes to the history in terms of the track intensity size when you get down to the specifics of each tropical cyclone. But we've done this preliminary verification, which hopefully won't change too much in terms of what the overall takeaway is. And the good news is, when you look at the Atlantic verification for all of 2016, we set some records in terms of track forecast accuracy. That's a good thing. Intensity forecasting was not quite as dramatically positive, but there are some good trends that I'll show you there as well. But at 24 to 96 hours, we set all-time records for track forecast accuracy in the Atlantic Basin. And we know as well as anybody else that we tip our cap to the folks who have updated and enhanced the numerical weather prediction models all these years that enable us to make these improvements. But the human is still very much in the mix for reasons I'll show you in a little bit. And here's that sample size. So more forecasts issued in 2016 than in the past few years. That makes the statistics a little more robust in terms of the track and intensity trends. In 13, 14, and 15, it was a little difficult to get a good handle on how well we were doing on intensity forecast improvements because we didn't have as many hurricanes and certainly not as many major hurricanes, the rapid intensifiers that can cause the really big intensity forecast errors. So it started to look like our intensity forecast errors were coming down, but the sample size was a little questionable. But 2016 gives us a little better handle on how we're doing because we certainly had some rapidly intensifying major hurricanes and several hurricane events this year. So the track error trends, again, we set some all-time records at some of these lead times, but they all came down in 2016 compared to 2015. And we've had considerable improvements during the past couple of decades. So this continues the downward trend in the forecast errors. But I still have to remind folks sometimes that this doesn't mean these track forecasts are perfect. And you know, the more that people get the sense that we're getting better and better at track forecasting, the more they start to get this false sense of security that if you say it's going north of me, then it's going north of me. And if you say it's going to miss my house by 20 miles, I can take that to the bank and that nothing could be further from the truth. And Hurricane Matthew could have turned out a lot differently for the east coast of Florida with an average error to the left. And I hope people don't think that that Matthew missed Florida by a lot and we can forecast that kind of difference next time. If given the same exact scenario next time in a Matthew-like scenario, those hurricane warnings are going back up again. I'm putting my shutters up again because we're not that good yet. And this is just an average. Sometimes you can be off more than this. But these trends are good, and we thank the numerical modeling community for all these improvements. Now, here is the official track forecast compared to the bevy of models that we look at. And again, this is all preliminary, but the overall sense of things probably won't change much. The official track forecasts are the heavy black line. Now, this is skill. So the farther up on the diagram you are, the more skillful you are, the better you are. And the official forecasts are very skillful and very near the best performing models when you take the average for the whole year. And those best performing models are the consensus aids, you know, a combination of several other models. And the GFS and the UK Met model were the best individual models at the short range. A European model did a little better at the long range. And we even saw some pretty good performance by the UK Met Ensemble. So again, year to year, different models perform differently. And we can't take one model to the bank on any particular forecast cycle to say, okay, that's our best model from last year, or that's the best model so far this year, so that one's going to be right. We'll just line up our forecast with that one. All models have good days and bad days. But we're, you know, again, relying very heavily on a blend of the most reliable models, these consensus approaches that we take. And even with those consensus models, we don't know which one's going to give us the best guidance. So the human still has to add quite a bit of value, especially when it comes to when the models are moving around. The models have the luxury of being able to go like this and like this and like this and like this, and they still do that. And you can't get mad at them and tell them to stop doing that because that's the way they were programmed for that year. But the humans, you would have good reason to be upset with us if we kept shifting our forecast back and forth, following an individual model or following the trends too closely. So we add a lot of value in forecast consistency. Now, on the intensity forecast front, this is good that we saw the errors come down from last year's pretty big spike in the magnitude of the intensity forecast errors. And even with more hurricanes, major hurricanes, and rapid intensifiers last year, which led to some relatively large average errors for the year, as compared to back in 13 and 14, for example, the overall trend is still downward, and that's good. We feel like we're starting to make some real long-term progress on intensity forecasting, but we're still talking here at 48 hours being more than 10 knots off. So, you know, day or two in advance, you know, take it to the bank. Usually we're going to be off by a category. That's an average. And it can be a lot worse than that in the rapid intensifiers. And sometimes the intensity forecasts aren't as far off when you got a large lumbering Cat 1 that isn't changing its size or intensity very quickly. But on average, we're more than 10 knots off. It can be easily a category off on average at a day or two in advance. But the trend is downward, so that's good. And then when you look at us, the humans, compared to the models on intensity forecasting, we were skillful at all times. So the humans have skillful intensity forecasts. So we don't want to say, you know, as much trouble as we have had historically with intensity forecasting, we don't want to say we're no good at it as an enterprise. I think we have some skill in doing this, but so do a lot of other models. And we were close to or better than most of the consensus intensity model approaches, which means that the humans are adding even more value on intensity forecasting. And that's a really important part of what we do. And again, you still see the statistical models not being as skillful. as, for example, the H-Wharf at some of the lead times. And that's another testament to the numerical modeling community. With the H-Wharf and the CTCI, which is the COAMPS model, using the GFS as a parent model, showed increased skill with forecast time and were the best models at day 4 and 5. This is a change from several years ago when we said year after year, only the statistical models were going to be the best ones on intensity guidance and not the dynamical models. And that's starting to change. And that's good because ultimately what we want to head toward is a collection of dynamical models, full physical models that can be our best guidance on track and intensity. But we still use the statistical models in the mix because they add to the consensus, which is still better than anything. Okay, so that's on forecast accuracy. So we're still making good progress. The Hurricane Forecast Improvement Project continues, still trying to improve the models and the changes that are coming to the Weather Service models. We're hoping over the next several years we'll add to that benefit. But you know, especially the global model improvements are made to try to meet a lot of different kinds of needs. They're not just made to help hurricane forecast. So sometimes models are improved in the U.S. or elsewhere that make them better in one respect and not necessarily better on tropical cyclones. So some and lose some there.
Greg Fischel, WRAL Raleigh. And I guess this is a philosophical question, and I fall victim to it as well, but the whole DPROG DT thing, you know, is that you want to assume maybe that the latest information is the best. And when the GFS and the Europeans started taking Matthew on that eastward track, I didn't bite until I saw the European ensembles, the majority of them, do the same thing. And that, in my mind, led credence to it, which in the end was not a good thing. So I guess I'm asking you philosophically, what's the best way we can serve the public? You know, looking at new information, yes, but not letting it send the wrong message.
All right. One thing we don't do in making our forecasts is give too much credence to one cycle change in one individual model. Oh my gosh, that means the whole thing has changed. I mean, there's a lot more we're consider. And we look heavily not just at a collection of the most competitive individual dynamical models, but we look at the ensembles of those models. We look at the GFS ensemble. We look at the European ensemble. In fact, before Matthew even left the Caribbean, and it was the weekend before it made its way up near Florida, and I'm briefing the state of Florida emergency management folks, and they can see the models just as well as I can. They're looking at the same stuff. And you know, there were a couple of cycles in which individual models would trend farther offshore away from Florida. But then I'd look at the ensembles, and I'd still see too many of the GFS, and especially European ensembles, coming even onshore in Florida and certainly closer to Florida, and had a huge spread. And I certainly did not bite off on individual changes. I'm looking at especially the longer lead times, looking at the ensemble spread among reliable ensembles and competitive models. But part of the answer to your question is this is why they pay the hurricane specials at the Hurricane Center what they do, so they can you know, put their expertise and their experience in the models and studying the trends, not just in this particular storm, but overall for the year and in past years, and understanding how the models have changed. And some of it is very scientific. Some of it is a communications thing too, where we don't want to change our forecast too much unless we're confident in the trends because of the decision-making message that could confuse. Now, that's not to say that we don't make big changes. Sometimes we do. And if we have a couple reliable models that have made a big change and we have some reason or confidence to believe that that's for good reasons that we can hang our hat on. If, for example, we flew the G4 jet the night before and that data went into the models, maybe we'd give it a little more confidence. We've made big changes before. And we win some, we lose some too. I mean, we've made some forecasts following one or two models that were over a few cycles suggesting something and ended up being completely wrong. I still remember very clearly Debbie in 2012 that had you know, the European going over to Texas and the GFS going over to Florida, And you know, we had to pick one, we felt. We didn't want to just pick something in the middle, which no model was suggesting was going to happen. We felt like we had to choose one. We chose the wrong one. So we're not always right in what we follow. Yes, John.
Hi, John Morales from NBC6 in Miami. So the human element of the forecast process, I think, is something that you've just highlighted, especially when it comes to intensity forecasts. The hurricane specialists have done an outstanding job. And obviously, when you look at the track guidance, your official forecast is right up there as well. But anecdotally, in practice, when you look at the tracks that you all trace, more often than not, it's going to fall along the line of the TVCN or one of the consensus models. And I would go back to the year of Erica, for perhaps a good example, or Joaquin, for that matter, as well, where there were significant challenges and significant errors in the forecast. And in Erica in particular, so the consensus model kept throwing her northwest into the Virgin Islands, into Puerto Rico, northwest into Hispaniola. That never materialized. It continued to go on a westbound track. My question to you is, I know this consensus is hard to beat, but when you've got reality versus the models, is there not a bit more of, can't we throw more of the human element and more common sense into the forecast process? Or is the fear of getting beat by the consensus too big?
No, and that's a very good question. And you know, for those of you who don't know, I was a forecaster. I was a hurricane specialist back in the zeros about a decade ago. And I grappled with these questions when I was on shift. And there were times when I felt, based on other information than just the consensus model tracks and knowing what models went into those consensus tracks, that I felt like I had justifiable reasons that gave me some confidence to deviate from the consensus by some noticeable distance. And sometimes that worked out pretty well, a couple times it didn't. There is no hard and fast rule that you have to stay within a certain distance of the consensus, but you do want to make a forecast that's pretty significantly different from that with good reason. Now, one of the places that I think we can learn from examples like Erica and others, and when you see the trends in our performance on intensity forecasts, a lot of times the situations in which we can do better on track forecasts than some of the models is if we have a better idea of the structure and intensity than the models do. Because in the case of Erica, for example, one of the reasons it went farther south was none of the models had it as weak as it ended up being, and they took a stronger system farther north. So if you go back to some of our discussions, you might see some examples where we say we're going some distance away from the consensus because we think some of the models are representing too strong a system. We think the current trends show for a weaker system. We didn't catch that in Erica as well as we would like. But there's the flip side of your question is, and this is where I think our conservative approach that you're highlighting is on balance over the long haul, not necessarily a bad thing. And that is, if you have a collection of consensus models that are adamant about a particular solution, and one or more of the forecasters thinks they've got something that gives them confidence that that's off by some distance, and we go away from that by a long way. Number one, in real time, people are going to wonder, what are they smoking down there? Because you better have a really good reason to go far away from all these reliable models. And then number two, if you end up being wrong, you better have really good reasons for why you made the forecast you did. So it's all about, we're getting better at this and learning year after year. And again, the intensity forecast verification bears this out, that we're learning more and more about how to add value on making the forecast of the intensity and the structure. And I think that's where we're going to make a lot of our human additions to the track forecast scenarios. Because I felt like as a forecaster, I could do a better job than some of the models on track forecasting when I had a better idea of what the structure and intensity were than those models that went into that. But there is no easy answer to your question because, you only want to take so much risk in putting out a forecast that isn't justifiable to be that different from the models. But if you do have a good reason, then you do it. And we don't have a rule against that. But we do have a conservative approach that I think is something we should continue to follow, because it is hard to out-integrate some of these really competitive models. Nobody can, you know? So if they're, but this is why the consensus approach, this goes back to someone else's earlier question, the consensus approach combined with looking at the spread of the models becomes a big part of this, because it's not just what some of the most reliable models are showing, but how much in agreement they are with one another, and how much spread there is with some of the ensemble members. And when there's more spread in the ensemble members, we're gonna be more likely to deviate from the deterministic consensus forecast, in addition to saying some things in our discussion product and conveying in our briefings that okay, the consensus of the various reliable models shows this, our track forecast shows this, but our confidence in either one of those is relatively low. So expressing our forecast confidence is part of getting the right message out.
Dr. Nevin, yes. And Doug Kammer with WRC in Washington. Joaquin was a perfect example. You've already mentioned Joaquin. You have the GFS going into the southeast coast, and you have the European, which is continuously taking it off the coast. I'm in a situation where I'm talking with NBC and talking with all the NBC O&O stations, telling them, and I bet that the Hurricane Center, the next run, puts the cone of uncertainty right up the Chesapeake Bay. It was essentially a worst-case scenario for Washington, D.C., even though there was no models saying that it was going to come there. So I can say that to people on the telephone, but when I'm showing that map on the air with a cone of uncertainty, I have to go on there and say, this is not going to happen. But it's almost like we don't want to go on and have any kind of a mistrust between you and with us. So when you have a hurricane like that, and you have that cone, how are we supposed to verbalize that to the public without the mistrust there that people might say that we don't agree with what the track is? Because I'm sure you guys in the discussion, which we can't put to the public, but that's a very tough thing for us to convey to the public.
Okay, yeah, lots to unwrap there. That's a good topic. And I think most of you remember I did your job at a media outlet in the past. I've been on that side of it. And number one, most of the time, there's enough uncertainty in the situation such that I don't think anybody would be able to definitively say, that's not going to happen. That's a rare case. Now, are there cases in which we are in the process of shifting the forecast because things are trending in a certain direction and we're not going as fast as some of the models in case they shift back, which happened in Dennis in 2005, by the way. They did this, and I didn't move, and I'm glad I didn't. So sometimes when you move, you regret it. But when you either have some trends going on and we're shifting the forecast, or there's two camps of models and we split the difference, maybe in those cases you could say, the chances of that exact forecast playing out exactly like that aren't real high, but that's why there's the cone. That's why there's the wind speed probabilities. That's why there's the storm surge products that I'm going to show, because nobody should be taking to bank the exact track forecast. Because look at the average errors. Even with these recent improvements in the last few years, at 72 hours, average error, close to 100 miles. And at 4 and 5 days, you're still up close to 200 miles. So it's not all that incorrect to say, this four and 5 day point is probably not going to be exactly what plays out. It's one of the many, many possibilities. So in that sense, I don't think there's a disconnect between what our exact forecast shows and what you're saying on television, if you're explaining all the other possibilities that could play out. Now, our discussion product is publicly available, sitting on our website. My dad didn't gonna read it, but I'm hoping that you all are reading it so you know where we're coming from, because we're not just making the forecast. We have, through that product, a way to express our confidence in the forecast and our assessment of what the models are doing. And there are times when we say, in that product, essentially what you just said, that our confidence in this particular forecast is very low. And the models don't agree, or whatever the case might be. So I think when you consider all of that, I don't think there's a whole lot of situations that are going to come up where we're making a forecast and you, based on other information, think it's going to do something else, and either one of us can confidently say, no, I'm right and you're wrong. I mean, there's enough uncertainty in all of this. I think that's what we should be focusing on, is where the hazards could occur given that uncertainty in track and intensity and size. Now, Joaquin is a special case because you had a very reliable model going to Bermuda or east of Bermuda, and a very reliable model, and actually several reliable models, taking it very close to, if not onshore in the US. And I remember one very difficult conversation I had with some emergency managers up in the Northeast when our forecast was going up the East Coast, but I actually did tell them, in that scenario, I think there's a high chance we're going to shift it farther offshore in the next couple of cycles. So I would recommend you don't make any really big decisions based on,
That's something that we would say on the air too.
Right,
we expect this to continue to trend.
Right, and I'm almost 100% sure we said something along those lines in our discussion product. So, but one thing I would ask though is if based on what our forecast shows and all the probabilistic stuff and what we say in our discussion, you still think there's a big disconnect between what we're saying and what we're saying is possible and what you think reality is, get on the phone with us or get on the phone with your WFO, and let's make sure we don't have a major disconnect that we can't resolve. Yeah.
Howard Bernson, WUSA in Washington. Rick, I'm looking at the trends. There's got to come a point, I don't know, decade, three, four, where the computers will supplant the humans in the forecast, won't they? Do you see that, or am I just misreading something?
Not in the real near future, and there are multiple reasons for that. One is, I alluded to it at the beginning. And there are certainly situations that John was talking about where we're not going to beat the models. And there are situations in which we are going to deviate from the consensus and we'll make an improvement. There are situations where we don't make that difference and the consensus models beat us. So there are going to be wins and losses there, good days and bad days.
That's why I said several decades, perhaps.
Well, two things about that. One is that one thing that, in addition to the track errors, track guidance, look, we're still way at the top. The humans are pretty far up at the top and still pretty good to listen to on the track forecast, even more so on the intensity forecast. But what this graphic doesn't bear out, and I mentioned it earlier, is the consistency in the forecast and in the messaging. Now, again, models have their bad days, sometimes the humans have their bad days, but in general, we are keeping our forecast more consistent. And I can point to you to many, many past cases, some of which I was the forecaster on shift, and that Dennis example is one of them, where us staying the course while the models were flipping back and forth added value in ways you can't measure.
I don't want to diminish the human value today. Yeah. I'm just saying if the trends are continuing, won't there come a time when the models reach their level of being that good?
Right. So where I'm headed is that maybe at some point in the shorter time frames, or at some collection of time frames within the current 5-day forecast period, this could be years away, I don't know, that it becomes consistently difficult for us to beat the consensus models. But keep in mind that at some point we're going to extend the forecast horizon. At some point we're going to go beyond 5 days. And then you'll have even more opportunities for the humans to be adding value. And then on the flip side, in the short term, that's where the humans are a lot better at conveying what the hazards could be. So I don't think it'll be real soon that the track forecast could be automated. There might be in the next several years statistics that bear out that that the humans are having more and more trouble adding value to the track forecast. I don't think this graphic sends that message, but in the future, perhaps it could at some of the forecast lead times. But I think it's going to be many, many years before the humans aren't needed at the longer lead times when we extend the forecast horizon, where you're still going to have these huge uncertainties. Take the day 2 to 5 problem and take that out day 5 to 7 and beyond at some point. And then in the short term, the models on track can get as good as they want and get as good as they want to on intensity, but the models have a long way to go before they can forecast storm surge and forecast the rainfall and the flooding in such a way that our products and our forecasts and our adding value there aren't really significant. So how many years it'll take probably depends on what forecast lead time you're talking about and what parameter you're talking about. But I would bet it's not during my career.
Rick. Dale Eck with Weather Channel. One thing that I did find, I think you started your talk this way, and that's why there is a need for forecasters and meteorologists.
Yeah.
I need to communicate what the impacts are going to be. And actually, we've kind of shifted in that direction. I mean, our forecast, I don't need anyone in the seat to produce a forecast. We do an ensemble. We weight it based on a little bit of history, kind of in this range, the Europeans a little better. We're going to give that more weight, et cetera. But then the humans sit down and they go, like you mentioned with the one in the Gulf, left or right. You know, at some point, that ensemble doesn't work. It's either going to be in Georgia or it's going to be in Chicago. And that's where the human comes in and goes, nope, I got to take a choice here. The ensemble doesn't work. And then there is the impacts. I mean, really honing in on, and we do this, we call them qualifiers. Yeah, the forecast, the automated forecast says winds are going to be 20 to 30. Well, they're going to gust to 60 here because there's a high potential for, you know, mixing down. And some of those things that the models can't do, that these are high impacts to people, that you just give them the numbers. I mean, you look at this last storm that just went through, the ice storm. Tell people, I'm sure some people were saying to people in Mississippi and Alabama, you're going to get 8 to 10 inches of snow. The algorithms don't always work. And sometimes it's that intuition. Where do the models tend to overdo it? Where do the models tend to underdo it? And we spend some time during that kind of, I'm going to minimize the amount of snow. I'm going to, you know, things like that, that we may get there. And I've been hearing it for 30 years.
I feel like I've been misunderstood
here. No, you're not. You're not. But I'm thinking that's where our where we come in. We can express the uncertainties. We can express the impacts kind of thing.
Yeah, follow up.
Clearly, there's a great need today. But as computational power gets better, as AI evolves, you know, there's got to come a point where we'll be able to rely more on the computers than we have to now. Thankfully, we have the humans there that are doing the jobs they're doing.
Yeah, now maybe at some point in the not-so-distant future, however many years, it gets close to that point on track forecasting. But the models are terrible at structure forecasting. They're terrible at storm surge forecasting, you know, in the dynamical model sense. They're terrible at pinpointing where the inland flooding is going to happen, where the rainfall bullseyes are going to be in many cases, not all cases. But the humans have a lot of value to add for the foreseeable future for a long time, along the lines of what, Dale, what you're saying. But also, even in the cases where we have to make a choice, because there's two different track outcomes, and we pick one, we go a certain direction. Even in those cases, our products that I'm going to summarize again today are still utilizing an ensemble of possibilities around that forecast, whichever direction we take it, which includes some possibilities of it going the other way. So we're, even when we pick one, or we split it down the middle, our assessment of our past forecast errors that feed into these products, these probabilistic products, take into account that we might have picked wrong. And especially in cases where there's a lot of uncertainty and models are going either way, what we say and what we brief is going to be different than when they're all packed together and there's a lot more confidence. Dale, could I ask you for another 3 gallons of water here? Yeah. Yeah, this is a fantastic discussion, and we discuss these things internally as well. And I mean, certainly within the Weather Service, we recognize that a big part of our role is in decision support and focusing on the hazards. But I still think it's going to be a while before the forecast itself is automated. But it's getting harder and harder to beat the models on track. No doubt about that. Wanted to shift gears only slightly, though. Oh, I'm sorry, Jennifer. I forgot to come to you.
I'm sort of a backseat observer when it comes to tropical forecasting compared to a lot of you there. My market's not impacted the same way. But talking about the models, how many of them, for guidance sake, are based on climatology as well? How many of them have inputs like that, where if our climate is changing, that's going to impact the accuracy as we move in time?
Well, we have a collection of both dynamical and statistical models that are used in both track and intensity forecasting. The dynamical models are using the current state of the atmosphere and how the equations and the physics would play out over the next few days. The statistical models, especially in the, sorry. the statistical models take into account a lot more past behavior and trends in behavior. And yeah, right. Yeah, the Miami effect is catching up to me here. So whatever trends that there are in tropical cyclone behavior over the last many years and in the climatological record that we maintain will be reflected in those models as they're updated from year to year. But beyond that, I think that the dynamical models would simply represent the current state of the atmosphere. And however that is different 20 years from now, they'd represent that state then. But the statistical and climatological-based models that we use, especially in intensity forecasting, even those are starting to not be as skillful as the dynamical models. They have some of that information on past behavior and trends in them. It's not a huge impact, no. Mm-mm. Okay, wanted to shift gears a little bit, but not completely, because what I want to talk about is one of the systems from last year that became Hermine, and those of you in South Florida especially will remember this system before it became Hermine when it was approaching South Florida, you know, north of the Caribbean. This was the first time that I ever launched a soft media pool for something that wasn't even a tropical depression yet. But because the potential was there for it to form and have impacts in Florida and other places in the next, you know, 2 to 3 days, we wanted to get out there on the messaging. And part of this was learning from situations like Erica and learning from other events where let's not wait until there's a hurricane watch for us to get out there on television and get out there talking with all of you media partners and framing the message. And it was more challenging than when you have an actual depression or storm because we didn't have all those products out there, and didn't have our track forecast with the cone, didn't have the wind speed probabilities and the other products that we would normally have. But we had this product, we had the 2 day and 5 day graphical tropical weather outlook, which in and of themselves are not that old. They've only been around for a few years. You know, it wasn't all that long ago where our tropical weather outlook was text only, had no expression of what the chances of formation were, and only went out to a couple days. All right, so we've made some progress along these lines to get to this point. And that's a good thing, and especially on the 5 day graphic, at least we were showing where the system could form, and that because it was moving west northwestward, it gave you some idea of where it could be causing some impacts. But if you fast forward this exact scenario to sometime this year in 2017, in all likelihood, because land areas, international included, were potentially going to be impacted by tropical storm conditions within the watch warning time frame, we would have already been writing advisories at the time you see here. Because in 2017, we are going forward with having the option to write our full advisory package, all the products and everything that goes with it, on what we will call potential tropical cyclones. And they will look and smell and feel just like an advisory on a tropical depression, or maybe a tropical storm if it's that strong a wind. The product formats will be the same, and the numbering system will be the same. So if we start advisories on something like this potential tropical cyclone number 2, and then it actually does become a depression, that it would become tropical depression number 2, and then tropical storm whatever. And then if we were to start advisories on potential tropical cyclone 5 later in the season, and it never does form, and then a couple weeks later you get tropical depression, we number 6. So we're going to treat these potential tropical cyclones as if they were already tropical depressions in terms of how we number them and how we convey them in the products. Now, when will we do this? It's when we think there's a high enough chance of tropical cyclone formation within the watch warning time frame, within the 36 to 48 hour time frame in land areas. So in this particular case, that would likely have been satisfied. High chance of formation within 5 days. On the left graphic, you see 50% chance within 2 days. That's probably high enough for us to have turned the crank on this. And you see all these land areas, Bahamas, Turks and Caicos, other places, that could experience tropical storm conditions within the watch warning time frame. So that's something we've been working on for a long time. We have the buy-in from our international partners on doing this new set of advisories on potential tropical cyclones. And it again enables us to get the right product out there when we need to, focus on the hazards with tropical storm watches and warnings and the other hazards we can convey in our product suite, even if it's not yet a tropical cyclone. And this is the front end. It's solving the front end problem that's comparable to the back end problem with Sandy. We can continue like we did with Hermine, and if a Sandy scenario came up again, we'd do it then. We have the option to continue advisories beyond the time that it's a tropical cyclone, and we call it a post-tropical cyclone. The advisories continue to flow. The hurricane and tropical storm watches and warnings can continue. The new storm surge watch and warning can continue. Same thing on this front end, high enough chance of formation within the next couple days, we could start advisories, issue tropical storm or hurricane even, watches and warnings, issue the full product suite, and continue to do that as long as the threat is there, regardless of whether or not it actually does become a depression or a storm. Does that all make sense? Does anybody have any questions about how that will work? Yeah.
I do. This is John Morales from NBC6 in Miami. Oh, gosh. Listen, I understand. I mean, this is a good thing. But what this means for the Miami market, you know what it means for this, first of all, this probably means that for Hermine, had this been in place for Hermine, there's a chance that there would have been a watch issued for Metro South Florida.
Possibly, yeah.
For Hermine, even though, of course, Hermine
probably would have been a tropical storm.
Did nothing for Metro South Florida. So I see the potential of a lot more crying wolf going forward with this. I understand that net-net, it's a good thing, but there are going to be some challenges in some of the areas that you serve.
Yeah, and in fact, John, that's one of the reasons why we treaded so carefully in moving forward and doing this. We've heard that perspective from a lot of folks, both domestic and international, that this would increase the false alarm rate, there'd be too many watches and warnings, and then and acknowledging that that possibility is there, and it might have happened for South Florida in this case. If you look at an event like Tropical Storm Bill in the Gulf of Mexico a year and a half ago, they had a tropical storm forming on their doorstep, but it wasn't yet a tropical cyclone. And we couldn't put up the tropical storm watch and warning until just a few hours before landfall. And that was not a good situation. And we've had other past cases like that. And we've also had cases of systems coming into the Caribbean. Remember Tomas, 2010, am I giving my years right? Coming into the Eastern Caribbean late in the season. And I was covering this on television, and you know, there were some impacts in the Eastern Caribbean and the Southern Caribbean that could have been conveyed sooner in our full advisory suite if we could have pulled the trigger on advisories as a potential tropical cyclone instead of waiting until it actually formed right over islands. You know, now, in order to avoid the excessive use of this, we're not going to do it every time there's a system that could affect land and could form. We're going to wait until there's a significant chance of formation. So if you've got a low or maybe a number of medium chance cases sitting off the coast of Florida or sitting near the Bahamas or sitting in the Western Caribbean and threatening Florida, for example, we might not pull the trigger on that because we don't have enough confidence that formation is actually going to occur, even though it could happen that Florida is impacted within the watch warning time frame. But if the confidence isn't there that it's going to form, then we won't do it. And we're only going to do it when it's within the watch warning time frame for some land area. and, of course, that does mean that not only could folks like in South Florida get these advisories sooner, you could get them sooner up in Washington, D.C. or in Raleigh because something's approaching the Bahamas and isn't a tropical cyclone yet, but we think high chance of formation. You might get your advisories a couple days sooner than it would have been in the past because we pulled the trigger on the advisory sooner to give these land areas the watches and warnings that they needed. So, you know, if you think about it, though, there are false alarms with actual tropical cyclones, too. We're not going to eliminate that problem going forward with this. And we will try to restrain ourselves to the cases where our confidence is high, that that formation is actually going to occur and that those conditions will actually happen. But it's a balance, and like you alluded to, I think on balance, this is going to be a service improvement. The feedback that we've gotten from partners in media, emergency management, internationally, we waited until that feedback was positive based on their full understanding of what we were going to do. And that's where we're at. So we're going to do this in 2017. And again, you play this one out again. You play Tropical Storm Bill out again in 2015 in the Gulf, many other past systems. Even Katrina. Here's a flip side to the Hermine case. We probably would have started advisories on Katrina east of Florida sooner than we did because it was trying to form as it was getting near islands. And that probably would have been a good thing, at least for Florida, to get the message out. Okay, so that's coming. That's coming in 17. And now I want to transition into talking a little bit about Hermine and Matthew and the especially the storm surge products. Just going to breeze through some of these examples. You probably remember a lot of what happened here. So here's the Hermine case where it actually did form as a tropical cyclone, in between Cuba and the Keys. So, in the overall scheme of things, this was still pretty close to coming ashore in Florida as a tropical cyclone. Could have been a tropical storm easily. Now look what happened when we got to Advisory 9, because this meandered over the Gulf for a while before it decided it was going to come north, and we got confident to make the forecast and put up the watches and warnings. When it was still Tropical Depression 9, we put up a hurricane watch for the Big Bend area of Florida after great discussion on the operations floor about whether or not there was enough possibility of this becoming a hurricane within the watch warning time frame. And we went ahead and did it because our confidence was high enough. And I think we were above most of the models on this. We were concerned about it having the chance to get close enough to or at hurricane intensity that we put up a hurricane watch for a tropical depression. That doesn't happen very often. And I was even, rightfully so, questioned about it on television. Rick, it's a tropical depression. What's with the hurricane watch? So this is one of those cases where the humans really did add their value, and we decided to step out a little bit and go ahead and put up that hurricane watch. And we're glad we did, because if we had put up the tropical storm watch, we would have had to make the transition to hurricane watch and hurricane warning later. We're much better off doing it sooner. But not every hurricane watch is created equal, right? A hurricane watch for something that's going to be 55, 60, 65 knots on that tropical storm hurricane threshold is not the same kind of hurricane watch for something that's in the Gulf, headed up north, going to be Cat 3 or stronger when it comes ashore. And that's where the messaging comes in. But so when we're briefing and when we're explaining what hurricane watch means, that you look at the wind speed probabilities to gauge the extent and magnitude of the event in terms of what the chances of hurricane force winds are at different locations. And then, of course, we issued the storm surge products and watches and warnings, even in the Gulf of Mexico. And then when it got out into the Atlantic, and then here's another post-tropical cyclone. We're having way too many of these in recent years, but such as it is, we got to deal with them. And we continued advisories on post-tropical cyclone Hermine, kept up tropical storm warnings. Of course, then it did, I think, beneficially, go farther offshore, at least for land areas, than we had forecast. And but this was in the Gulf and here on the East Coast a chance to operationally issue this new potential storm surge flooding map. And this is just a snapshot, if you didn't see it, you know, what it looked like. You have the ability. This is a snapshot from what it actually looked on the website. When if you're zoomed way out for a system that's going to be only impacting areas really near the coast, it's hard to see the details. But when you zoom in, you can see a lot of the yellow. The yellow is not just blue, but a lot of the areas in yellow with the a possibility of getting some inundation above 3 feet in a few areas pretty close to the coast in most cases. Good. Good. And so this, going back to Dave's question earlier, how do you deal with the category issue and you know, even for a post-tropical cyclone? And the same thing could be argued for a potential tropical cyclone on the front end is let's not worry as much about the category and the status anymore, and let's focus on where the hazards could occur. And despite what Hermine was no longer, it's not actually a hurricane anymore, losing its tropical characteristics, it still had the potential to bring the storm surge. And even though it didn't bring as much storm surge as it could have to some locations, you know, some of the stories and the shots that we saw from the coast of Delaware had the worst wave action and rip current that they've had in a long time. And I mean, so it was good to get out information here, even for something that wasn't fully tropical, and keep the advisory suite going, keep the products going, and focus on the hazards. Yes, there's still some hang-ups about the terminology, and we'll have to talk that through and work that out. But the good news is, no matter what was going on in your particular area, you could see what the storm surge potential was, wind speed probabilities were out there. And just to briefly go through the rest of Hermine, here's, I see your question. Let me finish going through Hermine really quickly since we're running out of time. This is the same advisory zoomed in on the New York City area, and you see a lot less of the potential storm surge being depicted there. A little bit of blue here and there, not any yellow. And so you're able to differentiate the risk from one area, one location to the next, even though they're all in tropical storm warnings, the system's hanging out offshore. We had a better idea of who could experience storm surge and get local with it, which I hope is beneficial to all of you. And then comparing that to where we had our prototype storm surge watches and warnings in effect for this situation, you see the hot pink areas in the prototype warning, but up farther north, New York City area, Long Island, it stayed under the watch, never went to the prototype warning, in large part because we never thought the potential was high enough there. And then when it went farther offshore by quite a large distance, then a lot of those storm surge watches and warnings got reduced. The area of tropical storm warnings came down. You see we're lessening the areas under warning as time goes on, and then just left with a watch for Long Island. So what this was able to do was have us convey the storm surge hazard pretty locally, differentiate the areas that could get storm surge relative to the areas that could get tropical storm force winds, and try to get people to not worry so much about what kind of system it was and still be aware of what could happen where they live. Yes, sir.
Jim Gandy, WLTX in Columbia, South Carolina. Will the storm surge graphic be available even when the system is not tropical?
Well, that's what's going on here. It's not a tropical cyclone anymore. It's post-tropical cyclone Hermine. But yeah, you're talking about systems that never were a tropical storm or hurricane, completely non-tropical the whole way through. We never issued advisories. Then the answer is no. This product won't be available yet.
Okay.
Within the Weather Service, we're talking about...
WFOs issuing that?
Well, WFOs have existing products to handle coastal flooding at present day. But going forward, we're trying to, within the whole Weather Service, talking to our partners in emergency management and media, figure out how to go forward on purely extratropical storm surge for something that never was a hurricane, isn't a hurricane. Because Hermine was a hurricane in the Gulf, we did our storm surge products and prototype warnings there. It was a post-tropical cyclone off the East Coast, we kept our stuff going then. But if it had been never been a hurricane, never been tropical.
Like the
system that affected the East Coast last January. A lot of storm surge in New Jersey, for example. That didn't see these products. But we're working on a way to get there, especially for the East Coast. Ocean Prediction Center, WPC, WFOs, we're all, especially we and OPC, are talking together to figure out what is the plan ahead for purely non-tropical storm surge. Because there's a lot of pull for this kind of product suite for completely extratropical systems. So, and we realize that, and we're trying to meet that need.
Can I just take this one second?
presentation. He's going to go back into this room for interviews. So if you have questions that you want asked, email them to Garce, because he's going to ask them while you're in the session with Rick. Okay, so he's going to ask those questions. So email them to Garce.
Okay. And your questions will then be uploaded, except for you, John. Yeah, I'm going to get them.
Great. Yeah, let me briefly go through a few things about Matthew. I mean, we could spend all day talking about a variety of details about this, but I wanted to highlight some of the products that we issued that were new this year, give you an idea how they played out. Again, long-lived major hurricane. By the way, we were briefing USAID and talking to our international Met services in the Caribbean when this was getting its act together down there. So we fully carry out our international forecast responsibility while we are doing our domestic responsibilities as well. And a terrible impact down in Haiti and other places to our south. Again, if you take that track, you shift it not too many miles to the west, and we'd be having a very different conversation about what happened in Florida and other places. This was a really close call to being a direct major hurricane hit, but still significant. And I've seen the damage firsthand. I went on the road, saw it in Florida, Georgia, and South Carolina, talked to the emergency managers, and didn't make my way into North Carolina because at the time in October they were still in response and recovery for the inland flooding. So, but saw the storm surge impacts, and I can compare what I saw to what our products were showing. On Advisory 27, when it hasn't even left the Caribbean yet, we've got the hurricane watch up for portions of the east coast of Florida. And another difficult decision, this is where the watches and the warnings are completely human issued, and this is where we had a really difficult call on how far south that hurricane watch should go, but we never included Miami-Dade County in a hurricane watch. We struggled with that. It was a close call with that angle of approach. And we kept that all tropical storm from Miami-Dade southward. But at the same time, on this Advisory 27, 5 p.m. on that Tuesday is when we first issued for the east coast of Florida the prototype storm surge watch. And what I want to highlight to you here is one of the big reasons why we went to a separate storm surge watch and warning and not just use the hurricane watch and warning to handle the storm surge is because the storm surge hazard often doesn't occur in the same place in the same time as the wind hazard. And that was our assessment here, too. Notice our prototype storm surge watch starts north of West Palm Beach, whereas the hurricane watch goes all the way down into Broward County. And we were able to tell emergency managers in Broward County, we really don't think this is a big storm surge issue for you guys. But Palm Beach County, farther north, we were heavily with the Miami WFO talking to the emergency managers in Palm Beach County and northward, helping them figure out which zones in Palm Beach County should evacuate. It wasn't going to be everybody, but there was enough possibility here that they needed to call some evacuations, and they did. So we were able to differentiate the hazards that way in very useful terms that the public could see and that the emergency managers could respond to. So treating the wind and the storm surge hazards separately is very important because we just didn't think there was enough of a chance of an onshore flow south of Palm Beach to create the storm surge. So that's where the prototype storm surge watch started. And again, it wasn't an actual watch or warning in 16. It was a prototype watch warning on a graphic that was experimental. But in 17, our goal is it all goes operational. And then, looking farther ahead, one advisory later, we changed part of the prototype storm surge watch to a warning, and the prototype watch goes farther north, and then the hurricane warning is in effect for the areas you see there. Again, tropical storm warning, Miami-Dade southward. But again, it doesn't line up exactly the hurricane watches and warnings and the storm surge watches and warnings. And another thing that's important here, if you look carefully, and you'll see better examples as I go forward, unlike the hurricane watches and warnings on the graphic on the left, which are simply a strip along the coast on our graphic, yes, the WFO has put out inland hurricane and tropical storm watches and warnings to depict the inland areas that could experience the strong winds. But our graphic just shows a strip along the coast. But the prototype storm surge watch warning is collaborated between us and the WFOs and then depicted on our graphic what is the result of that collaboration, such that you can get areas, not on the immediate coast, that are being depicted. And you can see a couple areas down there, just north of West Palm Beach and Jupiter, where the water's going in, the potential for storm surge is going in a little farther than just the immediate coastline. And then when you go farther north, watches and warnings being extended quite a bit distance farther to the north. But what I want you to pay attention to is look what happens up in the Jacksonville area. As we get closer to the hurricane impacting that area and we look more closely and talk with the WFO about how the water could get into the St. Johns River, look where the storm surge warning is, all the way down the St. Johns River, because of the onshore flow north of the hurricane as it approaches, pushing into the river opening in some scenarios. And there was a chance at this point that parts of downtown Jacksonville could get flooded. If it had come farther to the west and followed a track that was more directly on the coast, that could have been realized. And then you look up in Georgia, that prototype storm surge watch, look at all the detail that the graphic is trying to convey in terms of who's at risk. Now, again, the prototype storm surge warning, that's conveying areas that have a danger of life-threatening storm surge. Generally, we're talking 3 feet and higher above ground level. And the prototype storm surge watch was the possibility of life-threatening storm surge.
Right. Yeah. Just a quick question. It's Dave Jones with Storm Center. When you look at that product right there on the right-hand side with the storm surge watch and warning, do you intend or have you gone back post-event to, whether it's with USGS or whoever, to verify or validate how far inland the water has come or how far up? So then you can have a third panel that shows pictures of actually how high it came up to verify. So it's just that feedback mechanism.
And in addition to that, Dave, one thing I'm not showing you here because we just haven't had the opportunity yet with the postseason meetings and the holidays and all that to create the snapshots of the potential storm surge flooding map and what heights above ground level it was showing in these areas. But once we have those examples ginned up, then I will share them with you and be sharing them all off season. And in a lot of places, our product was forecasting the possibility of 3, 4, 5, 6 feet of inundation, storm surge inundation above normally dry ground. And we went in person with the WFOs and looked at some of the areas damaged by storm surge. And a lot of the water heights that we have ascertained are in that 3, 4, 5, 6 foot range above normally dry ground. So we think the products are calibrated rather well, that the right areas were put under the prototype storm surge watch and warning, the right evacuations were called for those areas, and it helped emergency managers make these decisions, and they've given us some pretty positive feedback on this already. So yes, that verification is going on, and in fact, we don't even have our full report on Hurricane Matthew done yet, and when that comes out within the next month or so, we hope, it'll have a full evaluation of the accuracy of these products. And
Rick?
Yes, sir.
Can you, I'm Kent from St. Louis. This flooding along the St. John, is that backfilling type flooding? That you're, okay.
Well, the wind is pushing the ocean
in the inlet
into the
okay.
river, I'm and then that is pushing the water
right
downriver, and not only causing the river itself to rise, but for it to come onto normally dry ground and potentially flood communities that need to be evacuated. And again, this graphic is trying to highlight the areas where there's a danger of life-threatening storm surge in areas that are normally dry ground, with the main call to action being evacuate if your emergency manager tells you to do so. So this is a communications tool for the public and the media to understand why there might be evacuation instructions coming from the emergency manager. But the emergency manager is going to be taking a close look at the potential storm surge flooding graphic that I showed you the examples of from Hermine, that have the yellows and the blues and the oranges and all that, that tell them what heights of water could get into what communities. That helps them make their evacuation decision. But this is a hammer for communication that says, you've been told to evacuate, and by the way, you're under a storm surge warning. There's a reason for this. And by showing where this hazard could occur, you don't have somebody from Orlando calling me up saying, could the storm surge get to my house? Well, maybe they still call, but hopefully people will have a better understanding of where the hazard could occur, regardless of the track, regardless of the category, all that.
Ben Strauss from Climate Central. Another quick question. Wondering what models or model ensemble you're using for the storm surge heights above above land. Above
yeah, in real time, it's using the SLOSH model. The computational expense of an efficient model like that works in an operational time frame, and because it does a pretty good job, especially when once we downscale it in a GIS environment to account for the details and elevation to get flooding above ground, but because the meteorological uncertainty overwhelms any benefits you might get in real time of running a fancier, more complex hydrodynamic model, we get the output that we need for operational decision-making using the SLOSH model quite effectively.
And when you compare different meteorological forecasts, are you taking a kind of median, a 95th percentile? No,
we're running hundreds and hundreds of forecast scenarios.
Well, exactly. So yeah. From those, how do you choose to produce your kind of single color-coded map? Are you
We have some probabilistic thresholds that are the starting point for the humans to decide where the watch and warning should go. But then the humans come back into the loop and say, well, okay, if we've got high confidence on our forecast track and intensity, then we don't need to expand the watch and warning a whole lot. But if we think there's a lot of possibilities for this going way over this way or way over that way, then we might have to expand the area under a watch or warning. But we do have starting points for the probabilistic thresholds at any one point, which what is enough potential for how much surge to warrant being under a watch or a warning. So, and again, the threshold for warning level storm surges over above ground is 3 feet. Okay. And the emergency manager seemed to like that threshold. Very quickly before I finish, one more thing that's coming in 2017, we can all talk about this offline and later today and down the road. We are gonna go experimental with some form of a wind arrival timing graphic, which is going to give you the possibilities of when the winds of tropical storm force might first arrive, which is a critical parameter because that's when preparations need to end, is when evacuations need to be completed. So it does have a tie to the storm surge question in addition to the wind. And we were looking at these in real time, experimentally, internally, just to see how the internal program was running. And basically what it does is it takes our existing wind speed probability product and it looks at the timing distribution of arrival of those winds at any one location and gives you, especially with the example on the left, what's the earliest reasonable time that those winds could arrive at your location? And we intend not only to produce a graphic that might look like this or like one of the other examples I'll quickly show you, but also provide you at some point, maybe not this year, but soon, just like for the storm surge graphic, we want to provide the underlying data so that you could slurp in the data at your station and then create a timing graphic for a particular city. And what we're doing by earliest reasonable arrival time is looking at all the possibilities in our wind speed probability ensemble, and we look at the time by which you're still ahead of 90% of the possibilities, so that you know that you're doing things in enough time so that you have high confidence of saying, if I get my things done by that time, the winds won't have arrived by that time. We're looking at different shading schemes. We're looking at overlaying them with the existing wind speed probabilities, which is the example on the left. So that would be the, you know, pick a point on the map in the colors, and that's your chance of getting tropical storm force winds at your point in the next 5 days. You overlay the lines, and it tells you what's the earliest reasonable time those winds might arrive. So it tells you what could happen to me and how long do I have before those winds get here, how long do I have to prepare. So this is going to be an experimental product on our website this hurricane season. That will be your opportunity to please go look at it, provide feedback on the website, let us know what you think, and then we'll decide if and when to go operational with it. But this year's experimental version, however it looks, we haven't decided yet. That experimental time frame is your chance to give feedback. Yes, sir.
Rick, Steve Weigel from WPTV in West Palm Beach. Have you been working with weather vendors on these graphics? Because this would take an hour to make manually. And it's not only this graphic, it's now that 5-day probability graphic, which in every other year I've eyeballed to try to match yours.
What we have in mind for vendors, and I'm thinking television primarily here, but also emergency management, is, and we intend to do this really soon with the potential storm surge flooding graphic. So both of these graphics, this is just the way the graphic might look on the Hurricane Center website. But our intent, probably not this year, but our development work will get us there. We want to disseminate the underlying data on a grid and then work with your vendors to bring in that grid to draw it automatically or to sample a data point at a city or community you're interested in, and you can generate graphics on your own that way. That won't be available this year, but it's never been my intent that anybody would try to manually draw this. We're not going to do that, and we want to provide you the data so you don't have to do that.
Well, even the graphic now, that five-day probability of something forming, that's not available from WSI yet.
No, we are trying to make headway on making the underlying data, whether it's gridded or shape files or whatever it is, to make life a little bit easier for you to bring those data sets in and generate graphically whatever you want.
Yeah, like you do with the probability of tropical storm force winds and hurricane force winds.
Right, exactly. Yeah. We want to follow that model. I know some of you have taken advantage of those data sets being in your systems, and we want to provide these data sets as well.
Like, I love this graphic, but I'm going to have to put this together somehow. If it's out there, I have to show it. And this is all, you know, your advisory comes out at 11. I'm on 10 seconds later. So.
All right.
Well, yeah. Obviously, I'll have to.
Yeah. And, but
I'm just raising the concern.
That's not a great long-term solution to show a web graphic, but.
Yeah, but it looks, you know. Well, I've been doing it for years, so.
Yeah, and while we're wrapping up, I know Dave's going to wrap us up here, but I'm just going to. Not read it all, but just flip by you what we're doing for our awareness tours this year. This is the schedule in April for the Caribbean tour. It's in the week of April 24th, and then perhaps of great interest to those of you on the East Coast. This is where we're going to be the week of May 7th. And we encourage many of you to notice we are purposefully choosing inland locations. We went to San Antonio on the Gulf Coast tour last year, and the best question I got from a reporter was, what in the world is a hurricane tour doing inland in San Antonio? I hope I get that question in Raleigh, but I think they'll know better there after this year. But anyway, you can see the places we're stopping, finishing in Miami on the 25 years since Andrew, and don't have all the details on every stop, but I wanted you to know the dates and the cities, and encourage your participation. Dave, thank you again for having me, and thanks for all the discussion and questions. Looking forward to interacting with all of you as the day goes on. Thanks to everybody online for watching. Looking forward to seeing some of you in your town this offseason.
Greg, thank you very much. This is terrific. Thank you.